Good morning, everyone. It is Sunday, May 31st, the last day of May, and it is Pentecost Sunday in the church. We are grateful that you have joined us on an absolutely beautiful, beautiful day, weather-wise at least, in Northern Illinois, and we get to celebrate the birthday of the church. And in the midst of all the difficulties that are going on in our world, and especially in our country right now, it is a joy to be able to have something to celebrate. So hopefully you will be able to join with us today in being able to be excited about what God has done for us through the church. At this time, I would like to ask Karen Newby to come forward, and she is going to, after we sing our first song, be able to do the welcome and the announcement. So our first song for today is Soul on Fire.
Okay, sing it with me. Thank you, Beth. Good morning, and once again, welcome to the Hope Worship Service here at First United Methodist Church in Princeton, Illinois. Starting off with church news. With the opportunity to do more out and about starting this weekend, we will be going to one devotion per week, likely sent out on Wednesdays in June. Please keep sending your prayer requests to the church, and they will be shared on Wednesday or Sunday during services. A small group task force has been formed to form guidelines on how to best reopen our church for in-person worship. There is much to be done to ensure people's safety, as well as to keep the internet services available. And the guidelines are shifting rapidly in terms of what we can and cannot do. So please be patient in our planning. We want to see each other again soon, but have the health of our parishioners as our utmost priority. Thank you so much for your many, many cards and condolences for Pastor Brian and family upon the passing of his mother. The cards are being given to him this week, and I know he has appreciated the outpouring of support and prayers. Meetings this week via Zoom, education Monday at 6:30, and return team Wednesday at 6:30. And now won't you join me in an attitude of prayer? In joy, we celebrate the birthday of your church today, O God. Pour out your spirit on all of us, that we will fulfill the dreams you have for our world. Recreate us as daring people, open to the new possibilities you offer. Calm our fears, because we don't want them to block us from receiving your power. Refashion our doubts, so that they lead us back to you in new and exciting ways. Come, Holy Spirit, this day to renew your church. Through Christ we pray. Amen.
Join me as we pray through this song. Word of God speak.
I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God speak, would you pour them like rain, washing
Thank you so much, Beth. That is a beautiful song, and if we pay attention to the words, we will certainly have a better understanding for the days and weeks ahead if we listen to what God has to say to us. So, hello, Rufus. He says hello. We were off for a couple of weeks because this is our first week back after a three-day Sabbath last weekend, and we appreciate being able to have that time off. Hopefully you were able to watch the Northern Illinois Conference Cabinet Service, and we're grateful that they provided that for us. But did you know that there is a birthday party going on today, Rufus? He says no, he didn't know that. Okay, well, whose birthday is it? He says it's not his, and he knows that Ryan's was a week ago, so what are we celebrating? Well, Rufus, today is considered the birthday of the church, okay? Yeah, I hear you. How can a church have a birthday? Well, what we're talking about is when God allowed people to be able to gather together and be able to do all kinds of awesome things together for Him. So that's what the birthday of the church is about. So we're going to definitely celebrate this. So I made you a party hat, okay? And yes, it's going to go down over your eyes a bit because somehow I made it a little bit. Well, okay, we're just going to stuff it over your head for right now. And trust me, it's going to be fun. And then I got you a kazoo or whatever this thing is, but you can do that later. So here we go. You ready? Yay? I don't know if you're having that much fun right now, Rufus, but this is what we do at birthday parties, right? We have lots of fun, and we get to do all kinds of neat things to be able to celebrate. Well, why do you think, Rufus, we are celebrating the birthday of the church? Okay, the church started, but why are we celebrating it? Okay, he says he really has no idea why we're doing this and why his eyes are completely covered up at this point. Well, what we're doing is we kids are celebrating the fact that we get to be together as the church. Back a long, long time ago, almost 2,000 years ago, Rufus, God decided to let all kinds of people know about His love through Jesus. And so the disciples were all gathered 50 days after Jesus' resurrection. Pentecost means 50 days. And so they were all together, and all of a sudden a wind blew through the room that they were in, and things like fire started going on top of their heads, and all of a sudden they started talking in strange languages that none of them understood. Sounds like a pretty wild party, huh? Yeah, I bet that was a fun one too. I don't know if they had cake or not, but it would have been kind of fun. So then they went out into the streets and they were able to spread the message of Jesus to all kinds of people because they were speaking all these different languages. So I would say that is definitely a party, Rufus. We get to be able to share the love of God with other people no matter what language they might speak, no matter where they might be at. We can now take that through the internet, through TV, through all kinds of things. We can take the love of God to all kinds of people. And I think that truly is a reason to celebrate. So later on in the service, we're going to be singing Happy Birthday to the church, and I hope that you'll join me for that, okay? He says he will if he can get this hat off and actually talk. Okay, we'll do that for you, Rufus. Thanks a lot. Now, usually this occurs on the Sunday nearest to Memorial Day because we're talking about the memorials of the church, but because we were off last week, we didn't get to do that. So we are doing the Memorial Committee report this Sunday. Every year around Memorial Day, I like to have the church's Memorial Committee talk about what they accomplished in the past year. Our committee is charged with receiving money that families generously give the church after a loved one passes away. Oftentimes this happens when the church is a designated recipient of the loved one's memorial funds. Giving money to a charity is a wonderful way to remember, respect, and keep good works continuing in that person's name. In our church, there is a designated memorial committee that keeps track of the funds that come in from memorials, and then they decide how the money should be spent. This year, the group is comprised of Bernie Brown, Chair, Jim Smith, Treasurer, Barb Skeen, Secretary, Sharon Smith, Margaret Palmer, Lorraine Cabral, Betty Sutliff, Jerry Campbell, Tom Newby, and Robert Lord. Some gifts are given for specific purposes. Some monies are used at the discretion of the group. Of course, all are greatly appreciated. Before anything major is purchased, the relatives of the loved one are contacted to the best of our ability for their approval. Thank you notes are also sent from this group. Attempts are made to purchase items for the church that aren't in the normal budget. In other words, things that aren't desired, that are desired but are not necessarily needed, or things that are definitely needed but after the church budget has been passed. This year, we haven't had a lot of activity in terms of purchases. In the last year, we bought some chairs for the children and youth ministries, and we helped pay for the new cabinet in Cushing Hall. We are thankful for the gifts that were given to the church to pay for these additions. Every person and group in our church can make recommendations for items to be purchased by the Memorial Committee. Just know there are no guarantees, though. The group gives thoughtful and prayerful consideration to every purchase. If you have an idea for a memorial purchase, please contact one of the memorial members and they will bring it up at a future meeting. There is a form now to fill out as well, so we have all the information needed to make a good decision. Again, thank you to everyone who has given to the Memorial Fund over the years. Many wonderful purchases have been made from it, and the committee makes these decisions with care. Our deepest appreciation to the family members who chose to give the money to our church, and may we never, ever forget the dedicated members and friends of Princeton First UMC who have gone on before us. Thank you. And now for our special music this Sunday, we realized that we hadn't heard from the bells in a long time in our church. I think it was back in February that we last heard them because, of course, the church building not being open due to the pandemic. So Karen was able to go through the archives and be able to find from a few years ago a performance by our Elm City Bells playing O for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. So we hope that you will enjoy this performance by our bell choir. As always, a very nice job by our bell choir, and we appreciate Karen finding that and blessing us with that music today. Joys and concerns. We will now lift up those things that our church members have shared with us for this week. We continue to have prayers for the Wooden family on the passing of Lucille, Mary's mother. A private service was held for her this week. We also continue to lift up Pastor Brian Gilbert as the cemetery service for his mother Linda was held this week as well. And for any others, including Anna Roadhouse, who lost her sister this week, we pray for all those who have lost loved ones. We also continue to lift up Charlotte Turnier, and she was released from the hospital and is back at home now. I got sent a picture of she and Susanna at home today wearing red in honor of Pentecost, because red is the color of the day for today. But Charlotte is still pretty weak, so we ask for prayers for her, as well as for Prosper, who's in hospice care, and also for Susanna as she takes care of both of them. We pray for all those who are recovering from surgery and those who are awaiting it. We also pray for all those who have had difficulties come up in terms of their health issues. We pray that they will be able to find the relief that they need and find healing in the best way possible. We share the joy of birthdays. The newbie's granddaughter, Emilia, has her second birthday this week, so we're grateful for that. And we also lift up the fire that happened on Main Street here in Princeton last night. There were three businesses that were affected by this. It started in a pet store, but thankfully no human beings were hurt. Unfortunately, there was some loss of life for various animals that were in the store. There's a lot of smoke damage to each of those buildings. But one joy in this is the people that were able to come out and help. Our own Stuart and Lynette Vanderventer, who are veterinarians, came and helped save some of the animals when they were given the clear to do that. So thank you to our fire department and for all the volunteers who try to help out with situations, difficulties like this. We also want to certainly lift up the situation of the victims of racism and the protests that are happening right now. It's an issue that certainly takes place not just here in America, but around the world, and we pray that we'll be able to find some answers for this, that we can all look deep in our hearts to be able to find out how we can help. I think we need to pray for peace. I think we need to pray for changed hearts, and I think we need to continue teaching the best way that we know Jesus certainly put out there, and that we are to love our neighbors, and that our neighbors may be different from us in certain ways, but that God loves them all, and that if we are truly loving our neighbors, that means that we think about and act in a way that God would be proud of. So let us be able to pray for peace and pray for God being able to work on people's hearts. Please also be sure to call and email the church office with your joys and concerns during the week so that we have them for the devotion as well as for Sunday services. And now, if you'll please bow your heads with me for the pastoral prayer, and then we will say our Lord's Prayer together at the end. Let us gather our breath as we gather our hearts and open them to you in prayer, our God. We confess that all too often we feel depleted. We run out of energy, out of time, out of patience, out of love, out of breath. That is when, as now, we need to be still. We need to know that you are God. Come to us in this time of silent quietude. Give us the courage to breathe out the petty grievances we know we need to let go of, to breathe out the resentments that linger, to breathe out the hurts that have found a place to live in us. And then let us breathe in the breath of new life, new love, new chances, new selves, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Hear us now as we turn over to you the difficulties of this past week and that which we will live into this next week. May we be assured that you are at work on it. And Lord, we are grateful for the many blessings we have in our lives, even when we fail to recognize them. Let us always be willing to recognize the good in life, even when times seem bad. Help us to recognize your Holy Spirit at work in our lives, and let us use it to make your presence and your love known in our community and our world. We pray all this through Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. And now I will ask Karen to come and join with me in our scripture reading for today. There is only one today, and that is because it is a long one. It is the Acts chapter 2, verse 21 verses passage that talks about Pentecost and the birth of the church. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues, as of fire, appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages, as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one, heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia, and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, What does this mean? But others sneered and said, They are filled with new wine.
But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you. Listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood, fire, and smoky mist. The sun shall turn to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.
This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Happy birthday, happy, happy birthday, happy birthday, have a happy day. If this song is sung to you on your birthday, you'd probably have a smile on your face. But you also know it's not the birthday song most of us know by heart and sing when there are family and friends celebrations. You see, up until February of 2016, the song Happy Birthday to You, written in 1893 by sisters Patty and Mildred Hill, could not be sung in public, where the majority of those listening were not known by the songwriters, a for-profit use, or in mainstream media that would go out to a wide audience. The song was under a copyright law that required a fee for its use. For years, this was battled about in court, until, in 2016, a judge deemed that there was no longer any reasonable evidence why it should not be available for public use. Happy Birthday to You has been deemed the highest earning single song in all of history, making its writers and publishers about $50 million in the last 130 years. For instance, it would cost up to $1,500 to include that song in a movie. If our church ever sang it in worship to celebrate someone's birthday prior to 2016, we could have been sued for copyright infringement. Thankfully, there's now no problem with people singing Happy Birthday to You to each other anytime, anywhere. And that includes in restaurants. Prior to this year, there's a reason you may have heard the little ditty that I sang at the start of the sermon when you were out dining. Restaurants had to come up with their own birthday songs to either new tunes or existing public domain tunes so they wouldn't get sued for infringing on copyrights. The one I sang at the start is sung at some restaurants to the old French-Canadian tune, Alouette. Now, here I'm going to digress just a bit because I found some very interesting information about this folk tune from the 1800s. Here is the first verse in its entirety. Alouette, gentille alouette, alouette, je te plumerai la tête, je le plumerai la tête, je le plumerai la tête, je le plumerai la tête, et la tête, et la tête, et la tête, et la tête. Oh, alouette, gentille alouette, alouette, je te plumerai. Now, how many of you out there know exactly what I was singing about? There's even a couple here in the almost empty sanctuary who know what that was about. But I'll be honest, I majored in French, but I didn't know what the word alouette means. Here is the gist of the song in English. Lark, nice lark, I'm going to pluck you. I will pluck your head, and your head, and your head, and your head, and your head. Nice lark, I'm going to pluck you. Interestingly, there are at least 8 verses to this song that speaks of plucking out the bird's head, beak, eyes, wings, legs, tail, and back. What a joyous song to be singing to children. It was composed by fur traders who were tired of being awakened by the lark's song, known in Canada as the bird of the morning. If they could only get their hands on that bird that woke them up every day way too early. We need to remember that not every song we sing that has a bouncy, happy chorus may have the words that go along with that attitude. But the song does still serve a purpose, and that it teaches children in Canada the body parts of a bird. I'm not kidding, they still sometimes use that in school. And it does make a suitable replacement tune for a birthday song as well. We will be singing Happy Birthday to You to the church at the end of the message today, because it's now legal to do so. But it is interesting that we came close to not being able to do that. It took an act of God to birth the church. Thankfully, the church is now in the public domain as well. But that is all due to the coming of the Holy Spirit. Did you know that Pentecost is the 4th most important holiday, holy day, of the Christian year? Christmas, Good Friday, and Easter are, of course, most important. But besides Jesus' birth, death, and resurrection, in terms of Christianity, if it weren't for Pentecost, the church wouldn't exist. Yet you'd be rather hard-pressed to find a Happy Pentecost card in your local Hallmark store. Maybe that's a good thing. This is one holy day that has not been taken over by marketers and changed into something different. For that, we can be grateful. It is the church's own. If only more people in the church actually knew about it and celebrated it. Because if Pentecost hadn't happened, there is a good chance we wouldn't be joining together for worship today. Think about it. What were the disciples doing 50 days after Easter? They were all holed up together in one room, kind of like they were 3 days after Jesus was crucified. They weren't doing very much. To be fair, they had gotten back into the regular rhythm of life. After 3 years of following Jesus throughout Israel, they realized they had to get back to normal, get jobs, pay attention to family. So even though Jesus had appeared to them every once in a while during the month and a half after the resurrection, they've started getting back into the regular flow of life. Then right before Jesus' ascension to heaven, 40 days following the resurrection, the disciples are instructed to remain together and wait for further instructions. Now this they do well. So let's just say that the message of Jesus' resurrection hasn't spread too much, close to 2 months after the fact. The disciples are breathing easier as none of them have been arrested by the Romans, and evidently the Jewish authorities have lost interest in them since their leader is no longer stirring up trouble. But that was all about to change in just one Jerusalem morning. We have the perfect setup for God to start this new chapter. There are good, God-fearing Jews from all over the Middle East in town for the already established festival of Shavuot, the Feast of Weeks. Those Jews who could make it were to come to Jerusalem to celebrate God giving the law to Moses on Mount Sinai. This is springtime in Israel, which means that people are outside and travel is easier. And we have the disciples more settled, calmer than they were right after the resurrection. All that leads to the experience they were about to have. Most of us know what happened at Pentecost. It was a typical spring day when all of a sudden the wind picked up inside the house and flames like fire began dancing above the heads of each disciple. Just as suddenly, they started speaking in different languages, none of which the people in the room could understand. But when they went outside, it turned out those were the languages of the people on the street, especially those in Jerusalem from other countries due to the Feast of Weeks. Many already believed in God. They were looking for the Messiah. This display of God's ability was enough to convince several thousand right then and there to believe in the new way God made available. And this new infusion of the Holy Spirit was enough to continue pushing these men out of the house into the unknown where people were hungry to learn about divine power and soul salvation. But it is interesting to think about what could easily have never taken place at all. Pentecost likely would not have happened if not for the propulsive action of the Holy Spirit. The disciples back then weren't that much different from disciples nowadays. We get into our comfortable ruts, and sometimes it takes an act of God to get us out of them. And if we aren't given exact instructions for our life, either from God or other people, then it's very easy to simply continue everything as is. Without the Spirit's push, all that Jesus had done in his 3 short years on earth would have been lost, kept locked away in just one small part of the world. It would have, in essence, been copyrighted information just to those specific people whom Jesus had touched, healed, taught, or saved. Jesus' being here would have made a difference for a few. And while the divide between God and humanity had been fixed, very few humans would have known about it. That joy would have died with the ones who personally knew Jesus. And the rest of us for eternity would have been kept wondering about the state of our souls. Thankfully, that is not how God handled it. He may have hoped that the disciples would do that on their own. It didn't work like that. They fell into a rut and needed a force bigger than themselves to do what God needed them to do. Thankfully, that did it, and we are here today because of it. So thankfully, guided by God and pushed by the Holy Spirit, the disciples became apostles. They were first learners of Jesus' way, then they became messengers, or sent on a mission, which is what the word apostle means. Armed with Jesus' teachings and God's strength, these men did what most thought impossible, grow a tiny religious sect into the largest faith group in the world for about 1,000 years to this day. This could have only been of God. But what that means for us is that we cannot keep our faith only for ourselves either. As stated earlier, we're human beings. We like to be comfortable. So even if we attend worship regularly, pray, and do our best to follow the teachings of Christ, we often have difficulties communicating our faith to others. It's either a taboo topic at the family dinner table, or we get nervous around strangers or even friends, not wanting to come across as religious fanatics and respecting the beliefs of others. But do remember what we're dealing with here. Faith is not something we should keep only to ourselves. We share recipes, either by card or over Facebook, because we've found something we love to eat and want others to share the experience. When we see a movie that profoundly impacts us, we let others know about it, as it might just influence them too. One of my aunts is constantly letting me taste new flavors of potato chips because she loves to find new ones that tickle her taste buds and then pass that information on. By the way, do not eat biscuits and gravy flavored chips. Don't do it, just trust me. Even if we'll never be Billy Graham-style evangelists, we can still let the power of the Holy Spirit blow into our lives and make a difference for the Lord. And that includes being willing to tell people when there's an interest in what has made a difference in your life. It's been a huge blessing that our church's worship services are being viewed by so many people online. And when I've asked people how they've come to do this, either by email or in talking to others, they said that the reason being is that other people have invited them to see it. And that's been the way for most churches during this time. Almost every church has seen increased activity in their ministries, or at least viewing their worship services, because other people have invited their friends and their family to be able to watch them. That means people do listen to what you say makes a difference in your life. Don't be afraid to share, when appropriate, the blessing that you found in God and hopefully in this church. It may just become a blessing for them as the Spirit keeps moving. But no matter what, always remember that you can witness to your faith by doing your best to live out the principles God gave us in His Son, and by sharing why you have peace and joy when people ask. Don't be afraid to give glory to God when the time is right. God may be opening up the door to that person's heart right then and there. But no matter what, don't keep the faith God's given you locked up tight. It's something that only gets better when you share it. The first effective polio vaccine was created in 1952 by Dr. Jonas Salk. Until that time, polio would hit teenagers and young adults at random, either killing them or forcing them to live with unusable muscles. The worst cases of this required some people to spend the rest of their lives in iron lungs, contraptions that would expand and contract the lungs for a person, but required the person to be on their back for essentially the rest of their life. But Dr. Salk came along with this miracle vaccine, and while it was extremely effective, it didn't cost much to produce. It effectively eliminated polio from the world. A reporter at the beginning of the vaccine's production asked who owned the patent or the license that keeps others from making, using, or selling an invention. This was Salk's answer. "I would say the people own it. There is no patent. Can you patent the sun?" Basically, Dr. Salk could have become the world's wealthiest man. People would have paid whatever it took to not get polio, but he decided not to patent it for his own favor. He never even attempted it. It would have slowed down production. It would have made the price out of reach for some of the poorest who needed it. Salk himself would have had to live with knowing that his invention was out of reach from certain people who would then either die or become permanently paralyzed. For him, no amount of money was worth compromising those ethics. I'm glad Dr. Salk decided to share his find with the world. It meant that no one should have to worry about polio anymore. Hopefully, we'll get to a point like that with COVID-19, and people and companies won't charge $1,000 a pill when it costs $5 to make them. Copyrights are needed for some things, to make sure people don't claim ownership when it's not theirs, to ensure quality is up to standards, and to adequately compensate people for their work. But there are certain things that should simply be clear and open to the public, letting everyone enjoy them, receiving blessings from their creation. Our faith is one of those non-copyrighted blessings. Feel free to share what and why you believe with others. You may just influence someone more than you'd ever imagine because of what God's Holy Spirit can do. To close the message this morning, we're going to sing Happy Birthday to You because, one, it's the birthday of the church. Two, we should be thankful and happy that we have a church to call home. And three, because we can do it now for free. Amen. Amen. Hit it, Beth. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear church. Happy birthday to you. And may you have many, many more. Amen. And now we will have the prayer over our offering. As we say every week, a big thank you to everyone who has sent in their offerings, their tithes, their gifts to be able to support the ministry of Princeton First United Methodist Church. We are so grateful for everyone who has done that because we are able to keep making a positive difference in this world because of what you're accomplishing. So if you'll please bow your heads with me now for our offering prayer. Oh God, we have thirsted, and you provided water. We've been hungry, and you fed us. We've been fearful, and you've given us your peace. May our offerings and our lives today witness to rebirth and renewal within and outside your church. Lord, send us into your world to make a difference, strengthened by your Holy Spirit. Amen. And for our closing song, which is actually the second to last song that we'll be doing today, we are going to sing together the song called We Are Called.
I love what the pastor said. This gospel that we preach, this gospel that we live, it is not in the least bit passive. The issue of social justice is echoed throughout the scriptures, and we are called. So join with me in this song. Sing it loud. That great day when all we the one God will reign, and we'll walk with each other, sisters and brothers, united in love. We are called to act with justice. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to serve one another, to walk humbly with God.
And as we get ready to end our service for today, there's one announcement I forgot to mention. Next Sunday, which is the first Sunday in June, we are going to attempt to be able to have communion for the people who would like to receive it. We will not be back for in-person worships yet on that day, but during the 8 o'clock service, I will be blessing the elements, and then between the services from 9:15 to 10:15, I plan to be in the parking lot to be able to, with a face shield on and with gloves, and we've got prepackaged, sealed communion wafer and grape juice that we can give anyone who wants to come driving into the parking lot, and we'll make sure that we have more information for you during this week on that. But just know that it's been a while since we've been able to celebrate communion, but we think we've found a way to be able to do it during this very difficult time. So please go into the world this week. Before we have our ending song, which is a new song called The Blessing that we want to bless you with, go into this world knowing that there are many, many difficulties. We are experiencing very tough times as a nation, things that we need to work on in our hearts as well as on our health. But we know that God's Holy Spirit can make a difference if we allow that to be able to move through us, pushing us to what we need to do. So we ask for God's Holy Spirit to be a part of our individual lives and in the life of this world, that we can be pushed to do what we are called to do. And now, Beth, if you would bless us with the blessing.
The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Please go now in the peace, love, and joy of our Lord. Amen.